Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship here at Our Savior Lutheran Church. Yes, we're back at the font one last time. On behalf of Pastor Randy and myself and Pastor Kristen with our campus ministry, Prelude Lutheran Ministry, we welcome you to worship. Bienvenido, because it is Pentecost, so I'm going to throw Spanish in from time to time. Wherever you are, we hope that you feel the undeniable presence of the Spirit. Whether you are with us in the sanctuary or worshiping with us online, we are glad to be together today. So I invite you to please stand as you so desire as we begin the celebration of Pentecost. When Pentecost Day arrived, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound from heaven like the howling of a fierce wind filled the entire house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be individual flames of fire alighting on each one of them. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them to speak. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, making life alive, moving in all things, root of all being, cleansing the cosmos of every impurity, effacing guilt, anointing wounds. You are lustrous and praiseworthy life. You waken and reawaken everything that is. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the wellspring of grace, our Easter and our joy.
Amen.
Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life. Hallelujah.
Immersed in the promises of baptism, let us give thanks for what God has done for us. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your voice thundered over the deep and water became the essence of life. Adam and Eve beheld Eden's verdant rivers. The ark carried your creation through the flood into a new day. Miriam led the dancing as your people passed through the sea into freedom's land. In a desert pool, the Ethiopian official entered your boundless baptismal life. Look, here is our water.
Here is our water of life. Hallelujah.
At your river, your beloved son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you opened the floodgates of your reconciling love, freeing us to live as Easter people. We rejoice with glad hearts, giving all honor and praise to you through the risen Christ, our source of living water, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life.
Hallelujah. We join in our opening hymn, number 399, O Holy Spirit, Root of Life.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
To our bones, and your Spirit brings truth to the world. Send us the Spirit, transform us by your truth, and give us language to proclaim your gospel through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from the book of Acts. When the day of Pentecost had come, the apostles were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in his own native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us in our own native language, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and in Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, and in our own language we hear them speaking about God's deed of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They're filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and of all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will show portents in the heavens above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm this morning is Psalm 104. We'll read it responsively, the congregation in the bold print. How manifold are your works, O Lord! In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures.
Yonder is the sea, great and wide, with its forms to diminish number, living things both small and great.
There go the ships to and fro, and Leviathan, which you have made for the sport of it. You give it to them and they gather it. You open your hand and they are filled with good things.
When you hide their face, they are terrified. When you take away their breath, they die and return to their dust.
You send forth your spirit and they are created, and so you renew the face of the earth. You look at the earth and it trembles. You touch the mountains and they smoke.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will praise my God while I have my being.
May these words of mine please God. I will rejoice in the Lord.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Hallelujah.
A reading from the book of Romans. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now, and not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. The word of the Lord.
According to John, the 15th and 16th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to the disciples, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from Abba God, the Spirit of truth who comes from Abba God will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you asks me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when she comes, she will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment, about sin, because they do not believe in me, about righteousness, because I am going to Abba God and you will see me no longer, about judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, she will guide you into all the truth. For she will come, not speak on her own, but will speak whatever he hears. And they will declare to you the things that are to come. They will glorify me, because they will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that Abba God has is mine. And for this reason, I said the Advocate will take what is mine and declare it to you." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated, and I invite any kids or kids at heart that want to come up for some time together. Good morning, my friends. So I have a question for you. What we just read, there was a word in there that I'm curious if you know what it means. You know what the word advocate means? Is it one you've heard before? Probably not. We don't use it super often, usually in kind of more like legal settings, but an advocate is somebody who is on your side, who wants to support you and help you, be a companion, especially when you're going through something like super, super hard. You want a person alongside you, because it's much easier to do hard things when you're not alone. So Jesus is speaking to the disciples before he's betrayed, and he's telling them, "I'm not going to be here forever, but you are not going to be left alone. Because after I go, God is sending the Spirit that's actually always been around, to remind you that you are not alone. So you're going to help me with something." So, confession time. I've been going to the gym. I don't have a lot of muscles yet, because I'm not that great about going as often as my trainer would like me to go. But one of the things we've been doing is I've been lifting weights. So, I want to... Gotta breathe through it, because it's hard, it's heavy. Oh my gosh. This feels real heavy today. Maybe because I didn't go yesterday, but... You guys don't think this feels that heavy. Why don't you think it's that heavy?
Because it's toilet paper.
Because it looks like toilet paper? Well, that is true, but here's the thing, and this is where I think it helps that we have an advocate, because it may not look heavy to you, but it looks and feels really heavy to me. And sometimes we all go through life where something that doesn't look heavy to anybody else feels really heavy to us. And so the Spirit, the advocate, is the one that moves within us to stand and sit and be with people who are going through hard things, even if it doesn't feel that hard to us. So I would like you guys to help me by lifting this with me, because it feels really heavy to me, but I think if we do it together, we can lift it pretty high. Do you guys think you can help me? Yeah? Yeah? Or am I just supposed to stand here alone with this super heavy thing that feels really, really, really heavy to me? And I might drop it soon if you don't come and help me. Please. Please. It's too heavy. I need your help. I need your help. Help me, please. Help me, help me. Oh my gosh. Yes. So let this be a reminder that things may look silly, but they may be hard to the person who's holding it. But as God gives us the Spirit, we also can be with people and help them through things because we trust that God has called us into community together, right? So remember this. This is heavy. Doesn't have to be for you to help them. All right. Let us pray. Repeat after me. Hey, God. Thank you for sending the Spirit.
The Spirit that lives in me
and lives in my neighbor.
Help me
to be a helper,
even when
things don't look so hard.
In your name we pray.
Amen. All right. And another way that we can help is spread a little joy. So I invite you to grab a piece or two to share with people around you. And make sure to grab one to share. Excellent, thank you. Ooh, that really was heavy. I should have dropped it? Oh, well then people would be for sure awake, so that maybe would have been a good idea. Well, today is a big day of celebrations. You may have noticed that Pastor Randy is not here because he and Missy are over at Milliken celebrating Connor's graduation. Yay! That's exciting. It's also my parents' 50th wedding anniversary today. Yay! That's exciting. And my best friend Katie's 40th birthday. Yes! And it's Pentecost! That should get the loudest. Cheer. It's Pentecost! Woo! Yay! It is a day to celebrate. It's a day to commemorate and a day to contemplate the ways that God is still moving around us. This day marks a noted kind of pivot and transformation in the life of the church. It's kind of the church's birthday, if you will, where God has again brought us into a new way to be in relationship with one another and with our divinely triune God, creator, and now ascended Savior, and the always ever-present Spirit. This day shows us a new hope, or at least reminds us again of hope, and invites us to consider how we are also active in our roles in this kingdom of God that is here and now and not just some other time to come. The Spirit is bursting at the seams to be fully realized for every single person, regardless of dialect or language, gender, level of melanin, disability, or sexuality. The Spirit has been present since the beginning. It's the same Spirit that has been poured over the mass assembly, and the Spirit does not choose favorites. The Spirit of God empowers each and every one of us to tell the story of God's incredible and understandable presence, and invites us off the sidelines and onto the playing field, which honestly is a really big responsibility, and it gives me a lot of anxiety. I mean a lot of anxiety, because that means we actually have to do something to be in community together, to act as though the kingdom of God really is here, because it really is. And honestly, even after the first Pentecost, even after that day, we're still trying to figure out what it looks like to be the kingdom of God here and now. And sometimes it might just seem a little easier to spend time in huddled rooms kind of like this, where we talk about it, rather than being out in the world doing it. And when I say it really gives me a lot of anxiety, I truly tell you, it's been a high anxiety week for me, and I don't always know why. But as such, because it feels hard, it doesn't look hard, but it feels hard, I have actually invited the help of some of my fellow clergy to share their words, as I became way too overwhelmed. I may be oversharing, but sometimes you gotta know this process takes a village. So much of what we're gonna be hearing today is from the tender, loving care of Pastor Eliza Tweedy. She's a congregational pastor in New Hampshire and gratefully shared her words with our community. So I'm part of a community on Facebook known as the Young Clergy Women Alumni, because young clergy women is for women under 40. And when you hit 40, you get booted to the alumni group. Thankfully, this group of regular old clergy women is still very supportive and helpful. So I am grateful for her. I'm grateful for that community that always seems to show up for one another. So thankfully, this is a reminder that we are not alone in our struggles and our fears and our desires to have plans before we act. The disciples and the early church community were not too dissimilar for how we also go about the work of radical gospel transformation. Even when the Spirit has been outpoured for us, how many of us love to have a plan before we do something? Most people. Who loves chaos? A few of us. Okay. So we need each other. But a lot of us like to have a plan before we do. And so this is not too dissimilar from the disciples. Because when you read our text in Acts, our first reading, this is actually what follows on the heels of the ascension. It finds the disciples who are in the position now of actually having to do the work, of having to be the presence and incarnation. They're having to feed the sheep and tend the lambs. When you read that first chapter carefully, you find that these disciples, these same ones who knew Jesus personally, they are not out in the streets doing the thing. They are back in the upper room, probably with a door that is still locked, because that is how they rolled. Now, if you ask them, the disciples Peter and James and John and all the others, if you ask them what they were doing up there, I bet you they would have said that they were planning. I bet they would have said that they are hopeful, even though they are locked up in their comfortable space surrounded by familiar faces. These are disciples who are fresh from the mystical experiences of resurrection many times and the ascension. They have been witness to the world turning upside down, and now they are sitting in a room together, so hopeful about a future kingdom of God that they will plant it right into the ground. Not too dissimilar for many of us. And as we look to the letter to the Romans, Paul is writing to this church in his last remaining writing, as it were. He tells them a few of the lessons he's learned about what it is to hope. Over the course of his long career in ministry, a long while of following the promptings of the Holy Spirit wherever she led him, I wonder, too, what was going through his mind as he allowed himself this little tangent that we heard today on what it is to hope. Because Paul, who is like the earliest disciples, even though he didn't encounter Christ himself before the resurrection, he believed that the reign of Christ would happen within his lifetime. He believed Christ would come again while he was still here. And now, as he writes to the Romans, he's coming to the end of that life. So when he speaks of hope, was he speaking to himself? As much as he was speaking to the church in Rome, when he reflected that we hope in things we don't see, and that which is seen is not actually hope, that we need the presence of the Spirit to breathe into us that which is beyond us, beyond our own expression, beyond our own experiences. And yet even Paul, with his years of work and ministry, his reflection is built upon years of forming and guiding young churches who are just trying to figure it out. He helped them into a way of discipleship where many still remained shut in a room, surrounded by familiarity, by a way of life that he also had come to know well, which he also infused into this new church, not entirely living into this difficult hope that forces us to consider ways of life that are very alien to our own understanding of the world, kind of like lifting toilet paper. Because for Paul and for Peter and James and John, who all still lived with expectation more than hope, in a reality that had not yet fully been internalized and held into their hearts, in the moment of the ascension, the word of the angels who counseled the disciples not to watch the sky, but instead to look around their world if they wanted to see Christ. And that's what we are called to do too, to look into the world to see Christ. Because hope is not merely the belief that things can change or that something can come. It is not merely the patience of waiting for God to act, for the church to finally become the church, which we're all a part of. It's not merely waiting for the kingdom to erupt into the world because it is already at work. And it's not even the patience for peace to overcome the violence of our time. Hope is active. It isn't idle. Hope is the embodiment of reality that does not yet exist. And though we believe, or at least we long to believe, that that world and that reality can. If you're familiar with the trilogy of The Hunger Games, anybody? Ish, sort of? Okay. Well, the main antagonist, his name is President Snow, he astutely remarks how dangerous hope can be. That if people who struggle through injustice and oppression, the people beneath him, see any possibility that they can hold any sense of power, it is hope, and hope enough to fight back and pursue justice, which strips him of all of his power. Spoiler alerts. I hope I'm not spoiling it. It's been out for a while. Okay. This is exactly what happens when Katniss, the main protagonist, who is also very unassuming and thrust unwillingly into this role, when she makes choices for her own survival, they ultimately pave the way for a new reality that at the beginning does not exist. Though there is a strong belief among the murmurings of her community that it can. Hope is not merely that which keeps us waiting. It's not simply that which gives us the patience to endure through hard things, or even as we wait for Christ to come again, that everything will be made right again when that happens. Hope is that which interacts with this outpouring of the Holy Spirit, that keeps its eyes open for opportunities that open before us when we're out in the world. Opportunities that will invite us to risk and to be bold and to cry out. Hope in the world that will build and work and find its way forward even when we don't know where we're going or what the end looks like. We hope until the patience we find is the patience we have to keep striving, and our waiting then is only to see which way the Spirit is going to send us. Until we can say, as unassuming and searching beyond our own survival, that it's not enough to look empire or power in the face and wait to be saved. It's not enough to endure with patience through times of violence and terror, trusting that they will someday be made right. But rather, we are a people of hope. We are compelled to live into that which we cannot see, but which we have been promised. And that even in the face of terrible odds, we take a chance, and then we take another chance, and then we take the next chance, until we win, or our chances are spent. Hope is what compels us to move forward until we can look at this world that is so very broken and hurting. And even still, we continue to care for the sheep and feed the lambs and continue to act moment after moment and chance after chance, that which is too deep for our words to even express. But that which was and is and is to come, the Spirit, this kingdom of God around us right here. And so we see that the kingdom of God emerges where there is hope enough to get up and out from our familiar surroundings, to leave our upper rooms with locked doors, to actually look in the face of empire and power and cry out for all to hear that this is not the way forward. The kingdom of God is the embodied hope that has been at campuses around the country, among protesters who understand well the difference between the governing party of Israel and the Jewish people, between the governing party of Hamas and the Palestinian people, and who push for a world in which their education doesn't come at the cost of bombs and blockades, entrenchment and escalation, that will never bring peace anywhere in the world. God's kingdom is the embodied hope that is beyond mere thoughts and prayers of students tired of active shooter drills and wondering not if, but when a shooting will happen to them. Students who take the chance of putting themselves in the public eye by challenging the gun lobbies, by speaking to whomever will hear in the words and language of humanity that guns do not kill people, guns do kill people, and we want to live. God's kingdom is the embodied hope of anyone and all who gather in legislatures and school boards protesting the mythologies that demonize the LGBTQIA+ community, in language that blurs and erases the very real concepts of exploitation and grooming, which has never been about access to diverse materials and the full inclusion of all people in our school communities and in the wider world in which we all live. God's kingdom is the embodied hope of places like LUM and LTHC, of all folks who are tackling stigmas head on, who are rewriting narratives that those who have been incarcerated or who live with substance use disorders or those who are unsheltered and unhomed, that they, until we see that they too are our kindred, they are our family, they are beloved children of God, worthy of respect and care, that God loves them, and Christ stands with them, and the Holy Spirit burns within them. For we are called to be people of hope, embodied hope. We are called to be disciples, because we know that when you sit too long in the comfort of the upper room, in the human certainty of plans, and the patience that feels like endurance, we know the Holy Spirit will not let us be, but instead drives us out, like howling wind and cackling fire, to live out our hope for justice, our hope for peace, our hope in the kingdom of God, that we know ours is also the call to the patience of chances taken and hopes that stand in the face of death, speaking the words and the language that is all of creation, a language that is of compassion and grace and justice. We are called to be people of hope, to take chances that the Spirit sets before us, to speak and hope and love and live a new world into being, a world that is birthed not according to our plans, but according to God's love. For we know that we are called to discipleship that is broader than that which is familiar to us, wider than our own experiences, and deeper than our own words, that we are called to speak, even as Peter did. Even if we feel entirely unprepared, or we feel that it is too hard, trusting that the words will come and allow us to speak beyond the human boundaries, and so by the power of the Spirit, we take chances, the ones that she sets before us, moving out of our rooms, out of our comforts, into the world, where we can be the active, embodied hope that ignites the spark of God's kingdom, blazing forth God's glory to all the world. And we know, as much as it will scare us to leave that which is comfortable and familiar and known, as much as we leave it to go into the world as we have known it, to step forward into a reality that might feel kind of like shifting sand beneath our feet, uncertain and unknowing what we are going to do before we even get out to do it, that we don't do it alone, that by faith and the Spirit we have an advocate, we have a God who loves us enough to always make sure that we are not alone, that through miraculous ways we will find communication and understanding, we will be able to build community and grow, that we too can dwell in the hope that love is more powerful than empire, that love is stronger than death, that love is enough to build the kingdom of God, to begin become our new reality here and now, and not just in light years away. Amen. I invite you to join in singing our hymn, O Spirit All-Embracing. Faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen, we believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, true light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. We pray for the church universal, for its ministries, and for the spread of the gospel. Shower your spirit upon Sunday school students, confirmands, and the newly baptized. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For the earth, our precious home, we give thanks for the diversity of plant and animal life on our planet. Empower us by your spirit to be wise and faithful stewards of all you have made. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For the nations and those who govern, for justice and peace among nations where war and violence rage, especially Palestine and Israel, Iran, Myanmar, Iraq, Haiti, Russia and Ukraine, Burkina Faso, and South Sudan. Give those in authority understanding hearts that they work together to bring justice and peace on earth. Grant all who vote in elections wisdom and discernment. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For those in need around the world, for victims of crimes, for victims of sexual abuse and exploitation, for those who are incarcerated, for all who suffer in any way, especially Danny, Zarima, Zara, and their family in Crimea, Zach, Lynn, Lawrence, Nathan and Haley, Jeanette, Sheila, Suzanne, Jean, and Megan. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For this congregation and its ministries, for those who plan and lead worship, for communion servers, for readers and tech ministers, for all who prepare and clean our worship space, may our worship be pleasing in your sight. God of grace, we remember the faithful departed. Give us thankful hearts for those who have gone before us in the faith. At the last day, breathe new life into our dry bones, that we might feast forever with all the saints in light. God of grace,
into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love, through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen. La paz de Cristo está con ustedes.
Also with you.
The peace of Christ be with you all. And if you are worshiping with us, a special word of praise and peace for you. Let us share peace with one another. You may be seated. As we prepare for our time of communion, if you are joining us from elsewhere, now is a great time to gather your elements of simple food and festive drink as we also prepare to receive in our community. It is especially important, though, that we say thank you for the ways that you continue to share your time and your gifts and your resources in ways that empower this community to serve the wider community, to be that spirit and living in that active embodied hope to which we are called to do. So thank you for the ways in which you do that. If you would like to give an offering, there is a plate here in the sanctuary. There is also a QR code in the bulletin and on the screen right there that you can scan and provide an offering that way. All the ways that we are able to work together to serve this community, community at large, and the world at large, living in that world. As we do prepare for communion, after all the elements have been blessed, I will commune the assistants first, and then those who wish to commune in the pews and at home, and then finally invite everybody to come forward through the center aisle. There is bread, there are gluten-free wafers, and there is wine and juice as well. The wine is on the outside circle, the juice is the darker liquid in the middle. All are welcome to this feast and to this table, so we will celebrate that. And as we get ready to do so, I invite you to please stand as we offer a prayer for our gifts.
Risen One, you call us to believe and bear fruit. May the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witnesses in the world through Jesus Christ, our true vine.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also
lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and prayers.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. Fulfilling the promise of the resurrection, you pour out the fire of your spirit, uniting in one body people of every nation and tongue. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your spirit poured out on all nations. We remember the night in which he was betrayed, when our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks. He gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you, for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast and grace our table with your presence. Come, Holy Spirit. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread and raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us and send us forth, burning with justice, peace, and love. Come, Holy Spirit. With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us in the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The table set by Jesus is open to all, and in resurrection, Christ is present in this simple food and festive drink. Jesus welcomes friends and strangers to this feast where the grace of God's love and goodness meets us where we are. Here we are welcomed, here we are affirmed, and here we are celebrated with the gifts of God for us, the people of God. Let us feast. Congregation may be seated, and I invite communion assistants up. I will need one more assistant if I can get a volunteer. Yeah. Thank you. Body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Thanks be to God. For those communing in the pews and at home, the body of Christ given for you. And the blood of Christ shed for you. And for all others, you may come forward at the leading of our usher. Thank you, friends.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us, Lamb of God. You take away the sin.
worship. How about that?
Okay.
Cool. Please stand as you are so desired. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the gifts of his body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever.
Amen.
Shepherding God, you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love. Send us forth from this banquet to proclaim your goodness and share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend.
Amen. As we go into this week, go with hope, as a sign of hope that the Spirit is at work here in the kingdom of God, before us, within us, and around us. We will sing our ascending hymn, Every Time I Feel the Spirit. Power, the Christ of unending joy, and the Spirit of Easter hope bless you now and always.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Go in peace, rejoice, and be glad.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.
Congregation, you may be seated as we have some announcements. And if you've been joining us on worship on Facebook, this concludes our time together. And we hope to see you again.